Let me start out by asking you to stand for the reading of the Word of God tonight. Second Timothy 1:7. We'll probably also be reading verses out of Titus and Galatians as well, but we're going to start in 2 Timothy 1:7. Just going to read one verse and let you sit down. Let's go ahead and pray over the message tonight. Father God, again we come humbly to your throne, boldly but humbly, Lord, accessing it through the name of Christ, who sits upon your right hand making intercession for us. We ask tonight, Lord, that you will open our minds and our hearts, that we can know and understand, Lord, that this will pull on our heartstrings, as the old saying goes, God, that we can come into a closer walk with you. Lord, that we realize defeat, Father God, is not something that has to be a part of our vocabulary, Lord, that quitting, Father, and giving in, Lord, is not things that we have to be a part of. Lord, you help everyone of the sound, Lord, of my voice tonight, or whomever will hear this later. And Lord, as I open my mouth, you feel it, Lord, I humble myself, Lord. God, I know, Lord, that I am only what you've created me to be, Father. And I thank you, God, for letting me know who you are, Lord. Forgive me, Lord, for anything between me and you. And Lord, when I open my mouth tonight, you feel it, God. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody say it. Amen. Let me ask you a question. How many of y'all have struggled? How many have struggled with defeat? How many of you have fallen off the wagon more than once for the same thing? Like a lot. And it's kind of bad because you do that a lot. It's okay. You can say amen. I've got my hand up for a reason. Not because that I'm trying to get your hand up, but because I'm saying amen. I'm agreeing to what I'm saying. Amen. We're going to start out in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You may be seated if you can. Thank you, Kyle. Just leave that right up there. Thank you very much. If you can do that, I'd appreciate that. Something happened the other night, and I was laying in bed after the fact, and I was praying, pondering, and I was praying and pondering about things. And if you've ever been addicted to anything, you understand the complexities of becoming unaddicted, for lack of a better term. We use a lot of terms in Christianity, like breaking addictions and breaking chains, generational curses, whatever. But if you've ever been addicted, you know the complexities of that. I had my own form of addiction that rocked my life and ruled my life for the better part of 14 years. 12 or 14. Sometimes I think it's 12, sometimes I think it's 14, and sometimes I just rather really not remember. And I was pondering all that because I understand how hard it is not to fall. Say some days, do you still get tempted? Well, yeah, I mean, I guess I do. I mean, not nearly to the degree and the severity that I once was struggling, but don't get me wrong. It's like, we'll take opportunity, Brother Kevin, to throw things back in my face. He ain't no dummy. And if he ain't nothing else, he's persistent. And he takes his opportunities. Thank God. Thank God that since 2002, since I give my life completely to the Lord, Sister Diane, I've not fell off the wagon. I will not say that I've won every mind battle, but I've won every physical battle. Amen? And I thank God for that. I give glory to God for that, Sister Danielle, because it wasn't me, because I had tried and I had failed. And I was laying there in the bed the other night, Brother Kevin, and I, the last thing I do, no boast, just stating something. The last thing I do before I try to close my eyes every night is I read a verse. And no matter how much I've read the rest of the day or whatever I've done, or how little I may have read, depending on the day, I read a verse. And I've got a couple of apps on my phone, and they don't use King James, and that's fine. And I opened up this verse, or that app, and this verse come up. This verse, that verse right there. And the last word, instead of sound mind, the last word in that, last two words, was translated into self-control. Okay? That's cool. And so, Kyle, I'm going to bring you something, dude. And y'all can bear with me just for a moment. If you can do that. I feel like putting this up on the screen. Now I gotta find it. Here we go. I gotta keep my screen from going off here. Hang on. Yeah. We got the automatic shutting. Anyways, here we go. Now we're cooking with Crisco. As Kyle Richard put that up, this is the Strong's translation, and Strong's is a concordance, and that dude went back in the 1800s, and he translated all the Greek and Hebrew words into modern words, and he done a really good job. Strong's is a very accurate source of information, and I don't know if you can see that, but the word sound mind, when you look at what that meant in the Greek, I'm not going to try to pronounce it, but I want you to go down where you see Strong's number, original word, translated word, phonetic word, parts of speech, Strong's definition. You see that right there? Discipline. Hey, there we go, Kyle. Look at that. Discipline. That is self-control. Sound mind. Another dictionary by the name of Thayer's. And admonishing or calling to soundness of mind, to moderation and self-control. Self-control or moderation. Now, I preach this verse a lot of times in the very classic way, Sister Tony, when we talk about our mind being at peace. What we know classically as a sound mind, Sister Deanna, where that my mind is not chaos. Can you say amen? Has your mind ever been chaos? All the time, Sister Tony says. Been there, done that. Didn't want the t-shirt. It wasn't. It's not good. Anyways, and I preach that verse, and that, I'm not going to disagree with that, because that is very appropriate. Even if you look, even in Thayer's definition, admonishing or soundness of mind, or calling to soundness of mind. In other words, it's not an inappropriate translation, but tonight we're going to focus on self-control. Self-control. And I thought it was so funny. You know, it has to be the Lord, Sister Diane. When you lay in there at night and you ponder these things and you pick up your phone, and randomly that's the verse that comes up when you open something up. It's no different than opening your Bible and a verse jumping out of the page at you, so to speak. God's in it. And I read that and I thought, wow. I thought, and I knew immediately when I read that, I thought, God's going to have me preach on self-control. And I don't know how much I'm going to preach or how much I'm going to teach, but I'm just going to roll with it. Y'all just go on with me. And I think as Christians, we fail to realize that we have a choice. Amen? I preached last week on sanctification. Wasn't it? Wasn't that what we preached on sanctification? Yeah, it was. It was the bowls. It was a really neat message. Not because I preached it, but the Lord had some good points about getting the bad things out of our life. And so maybe tonight this message is about self-control, which is keeping the bad things out of our life. Can you say amen? If sanctifying is getting rid of them, self-control is keeping them out, Sister Sheila. And that's right, Malachi. We were down at MIP's the other day, and one of them asked what the last book of the Old Testament was, and this one of the boys down there jokingly, of course it's Malachi, and the boy jokingly said Malachi. And
Well, if you look at it, you can say, I mean, it's spelled Malachi. Anyways, I said that in the car today, and Kelly's like, why are you calling Malachi Malachi? Talking about Malachi. I'm like, no, talking about the book of the Bible, Kelly. Anyways, ain't that right, Malachi? I'm glad you're up here. I think as Christians, we fail to realize, Brother Kevin, that we can't have control. That addiction of any kind. I want you to listen to me. Addiction of any kind does not have to rule my members. Addiction of any kind does not have to control my mind. I don't care how bad my body wants it. I don't care how bad my mind wants it. I don't care how good it feels. Addiction does not have to control me. You say, how do you know? Because it controlled me. And I let it. A choice. And you say, well, Sean, but it's more than that. Listen, I can see my struggles with addiction. I've already done that. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it's easy. But I can tell you that when I made up my mind, God was more than ready to help me. And thank God I have been 14 years in cleanliness before the Lord. Can you say amen? That's a God thing. How long did I go before? The longest I ever lasted before was a year. Out of that 12 or 14 year period that I laid in the hands of addiction, the longest that I ever kept myself straight was a year. Probably not even a whole year, but I don't know. But because of God, I have lasted 14. And you say, well, what does that mean? I'm going to tell you. Because that He give me a mind of self-control. Not of fear, but of peace and love and of self-control. He has given me the ability to say no. He has given me the ability to turn away my addictions. He's given me the ability to control my own members. The same part of my body, Brother Kevin, that denies God and does wrong things is the same part of my body, Sister Missy, that can tell my other part no, that I don't have to give in. I don't have to be a slave to my thoughts. I don't have to be a slave to what draws my mind. I don't have to be a slave to my memories. I don't have to be a slave to my emotions. I don't have to be a slave to what has ruled my body for so many years. I don't have to be a slave to those things. He has broken those chains for me. The moment He saved me and set me free, the moment that I give my entire life to Him, Sister Caitlin, is the moment that I got the ability to have self-control. Wow. You say, wait a minute, Sean. If I've got the ability to say yes and no to myself, are you saying that all the times I've fallen off the wagon, it's my fault? Well, since you asked, Book of James says that we're not led away by our own lust. We're led into temptation by our own lusts. In other words, Satan knows what to draw us with. We're just like catfish. You put the right thing on the end of a hook, we're very apt to bite. Can you say amen? You might as well just hear me. Because there's some of us that just absolutely glory to God. And you know it's true. There's some alcoholics out there in the world, Brother Kevin. If we can use that word, and you can never get them within 5 miles of a liquor store. They just, amen? And you say, well, should they be tempted that way? Okay, maybe not, but at least they've got enough common sense to stay away, amen? At least they got enough self-control to stay away. Now, I'm a firm believer that the Lord can take it away completely because He sure took mine away. But I already told you that sometimes I get tempted and it wouldn't be wise for me to be in the wrong places at the wrong time. I keep myself clean and holy before the Lord and I don't put myself in a position of compromise. Why? Because I have self-control. Amen? Am I bragging? No. Somebody who commenced up for 14 years straight ain't got no right to brag about nothing. Hey. I ain't got no bragging rights in this department here, guys. You know what I'm saying? I'm just telling you that we have the ability to say no.
We have the ability to overcome it. We have the ability to turn it off. We have the ability to shut it down. I have the ability to pour it down the drain. I got the ability to flush it down the toilet. I got the ability to get rid. Come on, somebody ought to hear me tonight, amen? I got the ability to bridle my tongue. I got the ability not to open my mouth. Oh, come on now. It's the truth. It's hard, but it's the truth. I got the ability to be self-controlled. Listen,
you say, Sean, do you have struggles?
Yes, I have struggles. I am forever opening my mouth and sticking in my foot. Amen? I have very clean feet. Because they stay in my mouth all the time. That's a disgusting statement, right? My feet smell like bad breath. We won't go there. Or maybe my breath smells like feet. I don't know. But they're there. Sister Diane's nodding her head. You know people like that. Listen, my mother. I have to tell this on my mother. She'll skin me. My mother's an unfiltered individual for the most part. It kind of just flows in one end out the other. You know? She had picked up this really bad, y'all ever picked up little habits of saying words you shouldn't? I mean, not words you shouldn't, just phrases, you know? And mommy had picked up the phrase, shame on you. So if you dropped a candy bar, it was shame on you. Or if you, whatever, you know, it was shame on you. It didn't matter what it was, mom's response was, well, shame on you. And so it was the early 80s, and children out of wedlock was extremely uncommon still around here at that time. That was still quite the taboo. And mother run into a lady at the department store there, and I don't tell you where. And she knew the lady and hadn't seen her in a long time, and they spoke at the front of the store. And the lady had a baby. And mom said, well, when did you get married? And the lady said, well, I'm not married. And mom said, well, shame on you. Said what, Diane? And mom really, it wasn't mom's instinct to condemn. It was not what she was trying to do. It just was, it had become such habit for whatever happened. Your shoes untied, well, shame on you. I'm not married, well, shame on you. That lady said, there ain't no shame on me. And mom just went on about her shop. And I don't know if she's ever talked to the lady again. But anyways, see, we have the ability of self-control. We have the ability, and listen, I want you to wrap your mind around this. If you're going to something for comfort besides the Lord, there might be a problem. Amen? Now, don't get me wrong. I have a wife that is wonderful to talk to me and comfort me. I'm not talking about that, because there's a way that you can find comfort inside the Lord. But now, just as an example, if you're hitting the bottle to find comfort, there might be a problem. And there might be really means there is, okay? And if you're looking at, glory to God, if you're lusting at everybody who moves, there's a problem. If you're taking drugs or snorting pills or smoking pot, there's a problem. If you're committing adultery, there's a problem. If you're flirting with it, there's a problem. If you're flirting with anybody and you're married, there's a problem. You see what I'm driving at? If you're committing gluttony and you're not controlling yourself, then there's a problem. And that's not a comment on obesity. That's a comment on overeating. I'm preaching on myself. Amen? And we've got a problem. Listen, if I'm doing anything that is limiting me from my potential in God, then there's a problem with that. Because I was not created to be a slave. It was very wet. I was not created to be a slave to my addiction. But I was created to be a servant of the Most High. I was not created to worship another master, but I was created to worship the Master. And if there's anything in my life that limits me from doing that, Brother Kevin, then there's a problem with that. And the Lord has given me not bondage to these things, but He has given me self-control in which I can choose around them, Sister Sheila, that I do not have to be in bondage to them. You say, but Sean, you don't know what I feel on the inside. Try me and I might. I don't want to get down to the nitty-gritty because that would be ugly, but try me and I might. I know what it feels like to think you want something so bad that you simply can't live. I know what it feels like to want something so bad that you don't think you can do without it. I know what it feels like to hide it because you know that you can't have it out in public. He said, be sure your sins will find you out and what's done in secret will be proclaimed from the housetop. It ain't a matter of if you're nailed to the wall for your sins. It's just a matter of when. He won't come calling. Hate that. God, crud, dude. Busted. You know, but see, He's given us the spirit of self-control. See, here's the thing. If God had not given us the power and the ability to choose around this, Sister Missy, then, you know what? Maybe this whole structure of things would be different. If He hadn't given us self-control, maybe this whole structure would be different, Sister Diane. Maybe He'd be like the rest of the world, be like, oh, he's an addict. You know, you imagine him and Peter up there talking that way? Hell, Lord. I'll use Lisa. Lisa's here. I'm going to pick on Lisa. Is that all right? Can I pick on you, Lisa? Okay, I'm going to pick on Lisa. Lord, you see Sister Lisa? Yeah. She's back on snorting the hydrocodone every day. She's up to doing 5 now, Lord. She got them 7.5s. You know, Peter knows things like that. And up to snorting them. But the Lord says, well, that's all right, Peter. She's just an addict. But see, that's not the way that works. That's not the way that goes. The conversation goes something a little more like this. Lord, Lisa's back on her drugs. And the Lord says, yeah, I know. But she knows better. But Lord, you know she struggles with it. Yeah, I know. But I've given her a mind of love and peace and self-control. She can choose around that if she will just call my name. If she will just give it all to me, then I will pick it up and she can choose not to and I will carry the load. She knows that, Peter. But that's not what we teach people, Sister Diane. We don't teach them there's freedom. We teach them to be tougher. We teach them to hold out. We teach them. But I'm going to tell you something. That's not what it... There's a line in the song, I believe it's Temptation by the 116 Click, and they're talking about, in that song particularly, they're talking about lust. Men, that Man Up album was all directed toward men and being better godly men. And that particular song, they're talking about lust. And there's a preacher who's doing dialogue in the middle of all their hooks and verses. And he says something along these lines. He says, holding out longer and being stronger is not being a man. That doesn't make you more of a man because you can hold out a little longer and put up a little bit more and fight off a little more temptation and bear a little more weight. But he said, what makes you a man is when you give it fully to God. That's what I've done. Auburn, Alabama, bed, wall, pillow, screaming, hollering, crying, desperation. I've done something that I have never done before, Sister Deanna, and I give every stinking bit of it to God. But here's the thing that I hadn't done before either. Before, I wouldn't even take my junk, but I wouldn't give Him the rest of me. But if I want to be free, I can have none of me. Because, see, I want to control the good part and let Him have the bad part, but that don't fly. God wants the good and the bad. He turns my bad into a testimony. He uses my good to glorify the kingdom. Can you say amen? And He wants that out of me. Brother Blake, that's what He wants out of me tonight. He wants to take all my stink and turn it for His glory, but He wants all my body to do His work. And yes, that is harder than it sounds. I admit that. If it was easy, everybody would do it. Can you say amen? But it doesn't make it any less true. I can pat you on the back and I can hug your neck and say, it's okay, honey. I know you're an addict, but that don't fly in the eyes of God. Will I pray with you? Yes. Will I counsel you? Yes. But I will never condone you in what you're doing wrong. I can't. Might even fuss at you a little bit, but I'm still going to love you. Amen? But God, give us self-control. I've just proved it by the Word of God. I have control, Sister Deanna. I don't have no excuse. Whose fault was that? Who just slapped me? Who done it? Was it you? Sister Lisa. Lisa just slapped me. Listen. No. I do it to myself. I do it to myself. Can you imagine this? Can you imagine this? What are you doing in the liquor store, preacher? I don't know. My legs led me in here. Yeah, I mean, come on. How'd you wind in the back section of this bar? How my legs led me in here? You know, I can't control my legs. They just take me anywhere I want to go. That's just what they kind of do. It's just my legs. My legs don't take me nowhere I don't want to go. Unless my feet come out from under me. Fell in the snow the other day. That's another conversation. But anyways, my legs don't have control of me. My arm don't go just kind of crazy and do its own thing. Right? How'd you get that joint in your mouth? Oh, my hand just put it there. And let me guess, once in a time it gets to your mouth, that your lungs can't control and it makes you suck in. It had nothing to do with you, right? I don't want to smoke pot. Don't make me. Amen? Don't inhale. Stop, lips. Stop. That ain't the way our bodies work. Come on, you all know better than that. We have the ability of self-control. And if I can make my legs run, or I can make my legs squat, that means I can control the rest of me, that I don't have to give in to sin. Can somebody say amen? You want to know why I don't exercise? Because I don't want to exercise. Amen? It's hard work, and I am opposed to hard work. It makes me like turn out moisture, and I turn red, and my breath goes away. I'm opposed to hard work. I say that jokingly, but somewhat seriousness. And who keeps me from exercising? I do. Well, Lindsay sends a Snapchat. I hope she got a brake fixed. There we go. Hey, look at my notes over there, Kyle. There's some Bible verse. I need you to put up that verse in Titus, please. It's on one of my notes there. Should be open. If I control the rest of my body to make it do bad or good, then why can't I abstain from my own addictions? Amen? I'll tell you why. Because I don't want to. Sister Tony spoke truth back there. She heard me. She knew where that was coming, didn't you, Sister Tony? Because I don't want to abstain from them. I don't want to run from them. Listen, does this make a lot of sense? Where are you going? I'm running back to the fire. Fireman just got you out of here. I know, but I love to get burned. Makes no sense. Makes no sense at all. Can you say amen? Amen. That makes about as much sense as me playing Russian roulette with an automatic pistol. It just, you don't win. It's impossible to win. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Can you all say that? All men. Teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Listen, let me dissect that. First of all, the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to who? To who? Now listen, there's like 15 of you in here, and I'm hearing two people. What's the last two words of that verse?
Amen.
I got like seven of you. We'll take it. Teaching us that denying what? Ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly. Righteously. Come on. That salvation, that we all claim is teaching us that we're supposed to live that way. Does God make me live that way?
No.
I choose to live that way, Sister Diane. Amen. I choose to live that way. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. If God ain't convicted you over something, it's hard for me to make you quit. Right? Now, let me just be honest with you. You go back a few years, I had some crazy religious idea from my childhood. And God had to work with me over Sister Sheila. Otherwise, I'd have never backed up on them. Amen? I had some things I really liked a whole lot, Sister Tony. But God dealt with me and I had to get rid of them. Some of them made sense to me. Some of them didn't make sense to me. But I want you to know when God dealt with me, I got rid of them, Brother Kevin. Video games, music. I'm not telling you what you got to do. I'm telling you what God dealt with me over. Amen? Video games, music, movies. Man, there was a lot of stuff that we got rid of with our chick. All kinds of things that we tore out of the house and throwed out windows and burnt and broke and whatever. I didn't care. You know what I'm saying? If it was between me and God, I got rid of it. Because I wanted to live holy unto Him. I wanted to be what He wanted me to be. And if there was anything that I liked better than God, it was gone. If there was anything I felt like God dealt with me on, and that it stood between me and Him, or that it posed some kind of a hindrance, man, it was gone, Sister Lisa. There was no question. Some of it was just because of me and my own desires, because I liked it a whole lot, and some of it was because it was really bad. Amen? Your affection for things can make anything bad. If I've got my wife before God, then my wife is a stumbling block to me. Amen? That don't mean I can get rid of my wife. Just want to clarify that right there. No, I couldn't live without her. Put that other one up for me, please, Brother Kyle. I like that. And you know, if you can't keep the joint out of your mouth with your hands and you live from sucking on it, how did you ever get the joint in your hand anyway? You know, who rolled it? Cursed hands. I mean, come on. It makes no sense. Why we do these things to ourselves? What's that, Sister Diane? Amen. I'm going to tell you what. Now, I like the Aesop's fable about the stork and the crows, and the old stork got blown off course, and he wound up in a farmer's garden, had a bunch of crows, and all of a sudden there's a net, and he was just trying to find out what directions. He said, "Hey, man, I'm lost. You know, got the GPS or whatever." They set off the net and caught all the crows, and the stork too. And here come the old farmer. And the farmer said, "I'm going to kill y'all." And the stork said, "Listen, dude, I just got blown off course, man. I'm totally here by accident." And he's like, "Hey, you should have been hanging with this crowd. Wrong place, wrong time, right there." But you know, you're guilty sometimes by simply associating. That's not to say that we can't be around people who don't go to church, because the Bible encourages us to be a light and a witness unto them. And we all, most of us, have to work around people who don't. You know what I'm saying? And so we have to learn to live around it, but not let it pour into our lives. Amen? Listen, just going to throw this out here. Just in case, okay? Just so I can say I made a stand on it. Don't come in here telling me about the swimsuit issue, from Sports Illustrated. That don't tell me about that junk. Don't come in here and tell me about 50 Shades of Grey and the new movie you went and watched. Or Magic Mike and whoever the other there ain't no place for that kind of lust and perversion inside the house of God. Can you say amen? Don't even. I don't even want to tell. I don't even. No. You ain't supposed to have eyes for nobody but your spouse. And if your heart's wandering anywhere else, you got a problem and you need to lay it up here at this altar. Amen? Just throwing it out there. Don't know why. Just felt to. People's like, just because I'm married don't mean I can't look at the menu. Yeah, actually kind of it does. Yeah, because Jesus said if you commit adultery in your heart, you just as well sleep with them. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not giving you permission because you've been lusting to go sleep with them. No. The preacher told me I could not. No. That is not what I said. I'm saying you need an altar, is what I'm saying. Because you got self-control. You don't have to do that. But you want to do that. Galatians 5:24 says, "And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Now, I want every one of you to read this verse out loud with me. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Last three words, affections and lusts. That means that when I am saved, the things that I was once attracted to, I'm not attracted to anymore. And the things that once drew me in lust, they don't draw me anymore. And if I found myself being drawn by them, then I need to do what Paul told me in other verses, and I need to crucify my flesh daily. What? There was a time, and sometimes I still pray this way, and I say, Lord, my flesh wants to, but I don't. Amen? That's a way to say that, yes, God, I'm struggling. I realize the reality. I realize the reality of what I'm struggling with, but God, I know what right and wrong is, and deep down, I want you, and I don't want this. And when I begin to pray, thank God, that when I begin to pray and say, God, my flesh wants this, but I don't want my flesh, or I don't want it, the Lord will help me put my fleshly part under subjection. It's the part where you pray your body down and your spirit up. It's the part that separates us from everything else in the world. Now I'm just going to get real with you for a minute, and you all just ride with me. Just hang on. And I apologize if this gets uncomfortable. But you know what separates me from a dog or any other living creature? But we're going to talk about a dog. Because dogs are nasty. You want to know how I know they're nasty? Because they eat your puke. And they lick their backside. And they smell everybody else's. I'm just being real. I ain't saying nothing. We wouldn't say if it wasn't church. It's okay. If I can't say it outside of church or in church, I can't say it outside of church. So what I'm saying out there, I ought to be able to say it in here. Another way to gauge what you say. Amen? Dogs are nasty. You want to know how else I know they're nasty? Because the book tells me that for outside are dogs and whoremongers and witches. Amen? Ooh. Did he hit his head? I thought maybe I preached on him. I didn't know. Dogs are nasty creatures. I know we all got them in the house, but they're still nasty. People ask me sometimes, why does my dog eat poop? And I say, because it's a dog. I mean, there's no better reason. They're just dogs. You can't take the dog out of them. But see, that's what makes us different between us and the dogs, is you can take the bad out of me if I let him. A dog will climb on anything that he wants to climb on. Whoever he wants to climb on. Whenever it wants to do it. The world teaches us, Sister Tony, that we ought to be that way. They do. Sheryl Crow made that song back in the 90s, If It Makes You Happy, It Can't Be That Bad. I thought it was a great song. I look back now and I realize it probably wasn't exactly conducive to moral behavior. You know what I'm saying? It probably wasn't the best thing to be put into my mind. If it makes you happy, it can't be that bad. You know, you think, yeah, this makes me happy, let's do it. Listen, we live in a world. Glory to God, guys, come on. We don't have no clean music. Other than the Word of God, maybe even a couple people push the bounds on that, but there's no clean music and there's almost no clean TV. Unless it's some kind of Christian-based TV, and then I see some stuff too, and I kind of scratch my head on that a little bit too. There's nothing clean. We have taught our children that it's all right to sleep with whoever you want to sleep with, whenever you want to sleep with them. And we've taught our children, or better yet, we've let our children be taught by what they're watching on TV, that it's all right to explore homosexuality because you don't really know until you give it a whirl. Hey, Brew. How you do? Yeah, no. I'm like in his space. That look is, what are you doing here? This, I'm supposed to be here. But anyways, we have taught the world that it's all right. If you don't like this one, just get you another one. And it's all right. You got to do what you got to do to calm your nerves. And that means if you smoke your five doobies, that's okay. God made marijuana. It's a plant. So's poppies, but we don't do cocaine.
But you know what? So is prostitution in Nevada, but it ain't no more right there than it is anywhere else. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Listen, it just is what it is. There ain't no room for it. There ain't no room for that kind of unsanctified behavior inside the body of Christ. You want to know why you struggle? Because you ain't clean from the world. I'm going to tell you that even when you are clean from the world, it's plenty hard enough, but you will not win as long as you're spotted by the world. You ain't got no hope as long until you get sanctified before the Lord. I'm going to tell you, as long as you're wading your toes in the piranha water, you're going to get them chewed. But we act like dogs because whatever we want to do, we do. Whatever we want to smell, we smell. Whatever we want to lick, we lick. And we climb on whatever we want to climb on, and we act like that's okay because that's what the world told us. But what sets me apart from a dog is because God breathed the breath of life in me, and He gave me a conscience in which I know what is right and wrong. And Paul wrote and said, does not even nature itself teach you something? And sin is sin, and right is right, and wrong is wrong. And I'll not compromise on it as long as I can stand for the Lord. And if I fall tomorrow, it don't change what is right and wrong. Can you say amen? I might be weak and fail, and you all might be weak and fail, but my God is able to lift us up, and my God is able to break my addiction, because my God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that's the same God that parted the Red Sea, and that's the same God that brought Daniel out of the lion's den, and that's the same God that raised the man from Elisha's bones. That's the same God that sent His Son to die on a cross, and that's the same God sending Him to come back again, and that's the same God who spoke the world into existence in 7 days. And you think you can fail and it'd be all right? Oh, we got grace abounding. Thank God. Amen. For our righteousness is as filthy rags. All have fallen short of the glory of God. But He said that He don't wink at ignorance no more. Amen. You cannot keep dipping your toes in the piranha water and come out unscathed, Sister Tony. It don't work that way. You say, Sean, I've tried and failed. Yeah, there you go. You spoke truth. You tried and you failed. How about you let God try? How about you give up your control? How about you actually try to serve Him with a whole heart? Are you being condescending? No. I don't mean to be. I don't want you to take it that way. Because I've been, I don't know who I'm talking to. One of you's, all of you's, I don't know. Whoever might be listening. But I've been maybe where you're at, where I had fallen so many times and didn't think there was any peace for me and didn't think there was any hope for me ever becoming free. I used to pray they'd find something wrong with me, Sister Tony, to justify my behavior. Right? That way I could say, well, at least I know why I was doing that. I really did. I'll spare you the gory details, but I was kind of disappointed one time. The doctor checked me out. There was nothing wrong. And I thought, man, I was looking for a reason. My reason was that I loved the world more than I loved my God. And I wanted to act like the world more than I wanted to act like what God wanted me to act like. I wanted to be like a dog, not like a human. I wanted to do what I wanted to do when I wanted to do it, and I didn't want no self-control. Dogs ain't got no self-control. We're lucky we get them housebroke. I mean, you know what I mean. We're lucky we got them housebroke. Me and Missy got a Pomeranian. He was an adult when I got him. Hadn't been neutered. He liked to pee all over everything. Like never got him housebroke. And you know what? If you leave him too long, he still ain't. I can take him down to the clinic. He'll pee on everything in there. Will he not, Daniel? Every corner, every garbage can, Marco will mark every bit of it. Why? Because he's a dog. Amen? And you know what? And there's some dogs who's had good obedience training. Boy, this is good. I'm going to hush, maybe. There's some dogs, Sister Missy, that's had good obedience training. When you get them in a show ring, they look good. And they'll jump through hoops, and they jump over jumps, and they sit, and they stay, and they roll over. And they can teach them all kinds of tricks. They've even got dogs now, Brother Kevin, that they can teach 1,500 individual objects by name that they can pick out of a box
on command, besides all their other commands that they know to do to help people. That's how much they can know. But you know what they do when they get a chance? They still sniff things they ought not sniff, and lick things they ought not lick, and climb on things they ought not climb on. So you can come in here and be the best trained dog in the world. And we got some preachers who are good trained dogs too. I don't want to take that out right there. Let's not separate anybody. Let's just call a spade a spade. This is a hard message tonight. But at the end of the day, Sheila, I've got self-control. What, miss? When no one's looking. Yeah, amen. When no one's looking, what do we do? What do we do when no one's looking? I have hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind, or of self-control. Self-control. Everybody say that with me. Self-control. I don't care how bad you want it. You still can say no. Amen? 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 One more time. Amen?
Amen.
I actually got most everybody that time. You're moving up in the world. You can still say no. Is it always going to be easy? No. But I'll tell you this much, the closer you get to God, the easier it becomes. Amen? There ain't no doubt in that. I know that for a fact. Oh, heavens. Feed that thing. Oh, well, I understand. Kelly was that way one time. Justin wasn't so bad. Kelly, but actually, we had to go around with Kelly, too. I meant Justin, too, is what I meant to say. Yeah, it was Justin we had problems with. Yeah. You get enough trouble, don't you, Kelly? Self-control, Kelly. Self-control. Preaching on you tonight, baby. I'm not really. But it fit, no, I'm kidding. But we have that ability of self-control. There's no excuse, guys. Why'd you shoot up again? I'm addicted. No. Yes, but no. You have a choice. Why'd you go back and buy it? You control your own body. I don't control it. Who's got the strings? Who's your puppet master that's making you do it if you're not doing it? Ask yourself. Self-control. Self-control. He's learning self-control. It's okay. He's got a temper. Let's take it after you or his daddy. Yeah, I'm going for that. We'll blame Brian. He's not here to defend himself. He's probably on up to it anyway. Yeah. Is he here? Oh, okay. That's good. Yeah. We're going to play a couple more songs and we're going to be done for the night. Tired of being out of control? How many of you are tired of being defeated by the same things? How many of you are tired of being controlled by your own body? How many is tired of acting like a dog? Come on. Amen. And when we learn self-control, we often go through the same kind of fit. Amen. You know you fight with God that way. You may not throw your hands exactly like that, but you know you fight with Him. And you try to bargain with Him. You try to bargain with God. Lord, I'll quit this if you let me keep that. God's kind of an unconditional surrender kind of God. That message came out harder than I thought it would, and I'm sorry, not sorry. But I know that God wanted some of us to hear it tonight. Maybe all of us. But you don't have to be defeated.
I didn't have to live in bondage for 14 years, Tony. I didn't have to be defeated. I didn't have to be a bad person behind closed doors, Sister Diane. I didn't have to be defeated. My legs never took me nowhere I didn't want to go. And my eyes didn't look at nothing I didn't want to look at. Amen. But thank God for His mercy and His grace. Thank God for His redeeming power. Sister Sheila, that I can be sanctified, that I can be clean, that I can be forgiven when I don't deserve it. You say, Shawn, you better than me, no. Some days I'd like to argue. Most days I'd like to argue I'm worse. I'm just on a little different leg of my journey than some of you all. That's okay. I'm glad I've done my over with. Because it wasn't no fun when I lived in that state. It's a cruel place to be. But I thank God for self-control. And you know, that makes a lot of sense because I never understood how that God helped me, but yet I made up my mind. I mean, I did, but I didn't. You know what I mean? It's kind of a... But that's it, because He gave me self-control. Wow! He gave me self-control. Amazing. This altar's open tonight. I know we've kind of had a round of altar call. But if you want laying on the hands tonight, I want you to come. We'll lay hands on you. Let them come. But if you're tired of being out of control, go ahead. Oh, you're fine with it. If you're tired of being out of control, this altar's open tonight. Come on.
I'm tired, I'm worn. My heart is heavy.
Here we go. Technical difficulties. But that's all right. I'm going to kill some lights here while he's trying to get that to work. And everybody will come over and turn his projector off. Why don't y'all stand to your feet tonight? And in a minute or two, if you want prayer, why don't you start lining up here? I want to tell you this altar's open and that you don't have to be defeated, that you have self-control. This altar's open. I want you to come and pray tonight.